Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Stephen Crossley, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled A History of Ancient Greece. Your professor is Eric H. Cline. A former Fulbright scholar, Professor Cline is chair of the Department of Classical and Semitic Languages and Literatures at the George Washington University in Washington, D.C., where he holds a joint appointment as an associate professor in both the Classics Semitics Department and the Anthropology Department. A prolific researcher, Dr. Cline is the author or editor of 7 books and has more than 70 articles and book reviews to his credit. In addition, Professor Cline has been featured on numerous radio and television broadcasts, such as the BBC World Service, National Public Radio, the Discovery Channel, the National Geographic Channel, and the History Channel. The rise of early Greek civilization prefigures and reflects the rise of our modern civilization. From its origins, shrouded in legend and the birth of religion, the stories of the gods, the Trojan War, to a decline in its own dark ages, to the resurgence of civilization in the rise of Athens and Sparta, and the flowering of democracy, we can see the past 2 millennia of history writ small, like a test run for our times. The lessons the Greeks learned in the course of their rise to power and subsequent fall are compelling and timeless truths, and their philosophy, poetry, plays, and history all consider the fundamental questions of existence that we still struggle with today. By looking at these early citizens of the world, we can learn what we need to do to make our own story a success. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin A History of Ancient Greece, Lecture 1, The Minoans and Crete. And now, Professor Cline.
Welcome to our course on the history of ancient Greece. Greece is frequently considered to be the cornerstone or the founding nation of democracy and Western civilization. Indeed, Greece gave us all sorts of things, not least of which is the concept of democracy. A lot of what Greece gave us actually came originally from Egypt and the ancient Near East. But Greece and its inhabitants twisted these ideas and made them uniquely Greek, and therefore uniquely a part of Western civilization. In previous decades, Greek history was thought to begin in 776 BC for 2 basic reasons. One is that this is the date of the first Olympics. We know the dates of the later ones and are able to count backwards by 4s to get to the date of this first one. And the second reason is that this is approximately the date that Homer and Hesiod began writing in the 8th century BC. And with the beginnings of writing comes the beginning of history. However, in the last couple of decades, archaeologists and ancient historians have realized that the history of Greece actually begins earlier. The Greek gods, for instance, are already being worshipped back in the 2nd millennium BC, that is, during the Bronze Age, the time of the Mycenaeans and the Minoans. They also realized that if you really want to understand some of the later Greek mythology, stories like Theseus and the Minotaur, or the myth of Atlantis that Plato talks about, you actually have to go back to the Bronze Age, because that's when the events happened that later become the kernel of truth at the base of these legends. So we will begin this course by looking at the island of Crete and at the Minoans in the 2nd millennium BC, and how this relates, among other things, to the myth of Theseus and the Minotaur. We'll also look briefly at Crete's international connections with Egypt and the rest of the civilized world at that time. We will then continue by looking at the Mycenaeans of the Greek mainland, and then proceed to the time of the Trojan War and into the Dark Ages that followed the collapse of the Bronze Age in the Aegean region, with a brief look at the first Olympics. We will then begin our second section of the course when we take a look at a series of lectures at the Greek Renaissance, at Homer and Hesiod, and the other writers of the 8th and 7th centuries BC. This will bring us up to the beginning of Greece in the historical period as we know it, and we can then look at the rise of Athens and Sparta and the origins of democracy. In our third section, we'll take a look at the Persian Wars in which Greece fought and defeated the mighty power of Persia, and how this led directly to the development of what we call the Delian League, and then directly to the Golden Age of Athens and the subsequent flowering of Greek culture, followed by a devastating civil war between Athens and Sparta. Then, in our final section, we'll take a quick look at Socrates, Plato, and Greek philosophy before turning to the rise in Macedonia of Alexander the Great and a look at his conquest and then his legacy of the civilized Hellenistic world. So to begin, let's turn first to the island of Crete and to Sir Arthur Evans and his discovery of the Minoans. In going to Crete first, we're going to the southern part of the Aegean region. The Aegean itself consists of the Greek mainland and the Greek islands, the Cycladic islands, and then Crete down south. Now, we're also going back to the Bronze Age, which is a period which lasts from about 3,000 to about 1,000 BC. And here we've got the kingdoms of the Mycenaeans on the Greek mainland and the Minoans on Crete rising and falling. We will look first at the Minoans and then at the Mycenaeans in our next lecture. In looking at the Minoans on the island of Crete, we are indebted to one man, Sir Arthur Evans. Evans came to Crete in the late 1800s, determined to find the Minoans. He was looking for the kingdom of King Minos and thought that he had found it on the island of Crete, specifically at the site of Knossos, spelled K-N-O-S-S-O-S. He began to excavate the site in about the year 1900. And when he uncovered a palace there, he thought indeed that he had found the palace of the legendary King Minos, and therefore he named the civilization Minoans. That's not what they called themselves. That is what we call them. In fact, we don't know what the Minoans called themselves, but we do know what others called them, because they appear in the records of the Egyptians and other peoples from the ancient Near East. We know the Egyptians called them the Keftiu, and the people over in what is now Israel, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, called them the Kaftor, or Kaftorians. Now, what relation this has to what they actually called themselves, as I say, we don't know, and frankly, it really doesn't matter. What we do know, though, is that there are a number of palaces on Crete, not just the one that Sir Arthur Evans excavated at Knossos, but six or seven other ones as well. Festos, Malia, Iotriada, Hania, Katozakro, the list goes on and on. And we also know the history of their inhabitation. Essentially, the Minoan period on Crete goes from approximately 2000 BC down to about 1250 BC, and it's split into three major periods. The first period is called the First Palatial Period. It's a time when there are major palaces on Crete. It lasts for about 300 years, from 2000 to 1700 BC. At that point, in about 1700, there seems to have been a major earthquake that destroyed most of the palaces on Crete. How can we tell it's an earthquake? Well, it can be tough to tell, but in this case, there's only two things that could do it. One would be humans using battering rams and other machines of war, and the other would be Mother Nature. We are opting here for earthquakes and Mother Nature because subsequently, these palaces are simply rebuilt. The culture does not change. The pottery stays the same. The architecture stays the same. The people seem to stay the same, which implies that there are no invaders. So we are opting here, and most archaeologists and ancient historians opt here, for an earthquake. Now, when the palaces are rebuilt, this simply is then named the Second Palace Period, and it's going to last from about 1700 down to 1400 BC, give or take 50 years in either direction. At that point, let's say 1450 or 1400 BC, there is indeed an invasion. And we can tell that the people that are invading Crete are from the neighboring Greek mainland, and these are the Mycenaeans, whom we will meet in the next lecture. The Mycenaeans take over Crete somewhere around 1450 or 1400 BC, and this then inaugurates the third major phase. It could be called the Third Palace Period. It's more usually called the post-palatial, period, and this is when the Mycenaeans take over. They themselves are then defeated by some power, probably the Sea Peoples, who we will talk about in a future lecture, and they are destroyed in turn at about 1200 BC, which is then going to usher in the Dark Ages. So we're interested in essentially three phases on the island of Crete during the Minoan period, of which the first two are the Minoans themselves, and then the third one are the Mycenaeans. So if we look first at the initial period from 2000 to 1700 BC, as I say, this is called the First Palace period, and here we can see a number of palaces scattered around the island, all of which look pretty much identical. The only difference, the only major difference between them, is that the palace at Knossos seems to be larger than any of the others. They all have essentially the same plan. There is a large court in the middle, a couple of monumental staircases going to presumably upper floors, and then quarters, rooms probably for the family members of the ruling family, and lots of storage areas for wheat, wine, grain, barley, you name it, because these palaces seem not only to be the living place of the ruling family, but also to be redistribution centers. That is, the villages and towns from around the palaces would bring their goods to the palace and have them stored there. In return, they would probably get some sort of little receipt or token that they could turn in when they wanted to for either getting their goods back or trading them in for goods of equivalent value. For example, if you brought in a couple of bushels of wheat, but in the wintertime you wanted a cloak or a pair of sandals, you could probably trade it in for that. So bear in mind that these palaces are not just the residence quarters for the royal family, but are also redistribution centers. And Crete seems to be rather unique in the Aegean for this, at least at this early time. We are here dependent upon archaeology, because although there is a little bit of writing by the Minoans, we don't exactly know how to read it yet. It's called Linear A. It hasn't been completely deciphered and translated yet. So we are beholden to archaeology at this point, and one of the things that archaeologists have uncovered are little tiny pictures, mosaics, if you will, of townhouses. And so we can see what the houses of the ordinary people may well have looked like at this time. And they are, as you might imagine, fairly small affairs, probably made out of mud brick with some timbers and stones, interspersed, nice windows, nice doors, but not living at exactly the level that the king is living at in the palace itself. We've also got pottery at this period, and Minoan pottery is rather distinctive. They tended to favor outdoor motifs. They liked flora, they liked fauna, and they in particular liked nautical themes, octopus, fish, and birds and other animals as well. There is one particular type of pottery that is found far abroad. That it's found in Egypt, it's found in Cyprus. It's very distinctively Minoan there. It's called Camaras ware, K-A-M-A-R-E-S. Camaras ware is orange and black and white and is eggshell thin. It's very, very fragile. It's absolutely exquisite, and it's only made during this Minoan period. So we can tell that the Minoans are in contact with people living in Egypt and Cyprus and even as far away as Mesopotamia, modern-day Iraq, as well. So these are the types of things that archaeology can give us at this point in time. We also have a number of burials, a number of tombs with the gold objects that you might expect in here. And we find objects of religious significance as well. Now, I should caution you that when archaeologists find things that they don't really know too much about, they tend to call them religious or cultic in nature, but in some cases they actually do seem to be actually religious or cultic in nature. And the Minoan double axe is one of these items. The double axe can come in any number of sizes. Quite frequently it's in miniature and is made out of things like gold foil, which obviously is not very functional. And we find these standing on altars or stands in obviously religious context. So it looks like the Minoans, for some reason and in some way, used a double axe in their religious rituals. Now, from this early period, we also find Minoan snake goddesses. These continue also later, but Minoan snake goddesses are rather interesting. What they are is actually about 6-inch tall figurines made in ivory of women wearing long flounced dresses and an open bodice so that their breasts are visible. Seems to be a very typical way of Minoan dressing. They're holding snakes in their hands, and they have a dove on their head occasionally. I don't quite know why they've got the dove on their head, but they are handling snakes, much as snake handlers do today in some religions. And they are quite enigmatic because there is nothing found in the context that would actually describe what they are or what they are doing. So, as I mentioned, since archaeologists tend to think things are religious when they don't know what they are, these have been called snake goddesses. Though there is a good deal of discussion, as you might imagine. Some people say these are not goddesses, but they are in fact priestesses who are worshiping the goddess. Others say no, these are the queen or her attendants. Others say these are just normal women, and the debate goes on and on. The most interesting aspect about these Minoan snake goddesses, however, is that it turns out that most of them are forged. They are forgeries. Sir Arthur Evans at Knossos only found 2 or 3 of them, and yet there are any number, I'd say a dozen or maybe as many as 20, that can be seen in the museums of the world today. It turns out that Evans's master craftsman was faking these on the side. Evans had asked him to produce a couple of them so he could use them or give them away, and his master craftsman seemed to have thought this was a very good idea, so he made some more of them. So if you go to museums across the United States and even some in Europe, you will find these, and about 90% of them are forgeries. If we move on to the second palatial period, that is neo-palatial Knossos, the difference between the first palace period and the second palace period, as I've mentioned, is an earthquake that seems to have destroyed most, if not all, of the palaces on Crete. But they simply pick up and rebuild. And the same status quo holds. Most of these palaces look almost identical to each other, but the one at Knossos is larger than all the others, and it is generally assumed that this was the place where the ruling family of Crete lived and worked out of. Now, if we take a look at the plan of neo-palatial Knossos, it has a similar plan to the others, as I mentioned. It's got the huge central court. It's got king's quarters. It's got quarters for the queen. And it has a series of storage rooms, one after the other, along one side of the palace. There were also second floor and a third floor, but what is left now today to walk among is mostly the first floor. And it is these ruins that probably gave rise, in part, to the myth of Theseus and the Minotaur. Knossos was destroyed, along with the rest of the palaces, by about 1200 BC. And these ruins then lay there for a good 300 or 400 years. And one can imagine what somebody coming along in, say, 800 BC thought of these ruins, which looked suspiciously like a maze or a labyrinth. And so part of the tale of Theseus and the Minotaur, in particular where Theseus comes over from Athens, along with the other boys and girls who are sent as tribute each year to King Minos and are sent down to the basement of the palace there to face the Minotaur, this half-man, half-bull. You can see how later people, looking at this maze of ruins, might have begun to come up with this idea for the myth. But there are other components that we'll talk about in just a moment that have to factor in here, namely, where does the half-bull, half-man idea come in? Now, at Knossos, Evans excavated with a huge team of workmen. He excavated in what all archaeologists should wear, solid white along with a very dapper pith helmet. I imagine he was sipping his gin and tonics under the shade while his workmen brought him items. And we see pictures of him dressed in just such an outfit. He did get his hands dirty. He did a very good job excavating Knossos for the most part. One thing he did, though, is a little disquieting, shall we say. Evans decided that the people that were to come to visit the site, we would call them tourists, needed to know what the palace of the Minoans looked like. And so as he excavated, he also rebuilt and reconstructed. And so if you go to Knossos today, you will see part of the palace reconstructed up to its second and even its third floor. Now, for most people, this is fine and dandy. You can actually see what the palace looked like. The only problem is you are seeing what the palace looked like according to Sir Arthur Evans's reconstruction, which is not necessarily the way that it actually looked, because Evans made mistakes. We know that for a fact. And still, if you go to the site today, what you are seeing is Evans's reconstruction. So archaeologists have a problem here. Do you reconstruct so the average layperson can actually understand what they're looking at, as opposed to just seeing a pile of rocks on the ground? Or do you just leave the pile of rocks? Most think that you should milk the site for all the data that you can, and then and only then put up the reconstruction. Unfortunately, Evans started reconstructing as he was digging, and he did it using concrete, so it's a little bit hard to undo what he's done. Still, for the most part, it wasn't too bad. And if you look at artist reconstructions of what Knossos would have looked like, one notices a couple of things. First is that the palace is very light and airy, wide open. The climate of Crete is very much like the climate of Southern California. It's very warm for most of the year, and we can see piers and doors, that is, pillars with open corridors where you could walk and feel the gentle breezes and feel the sun and hear the birds. A very nice connection with nature, shall we say. And indeed, people thought of the Minoans as nature lovers. Now, the other thing that one can see in looking at Knossos is not only this large central courtyard, but also that the entire palace seems to have been unfortified. That is, there are no defensive walls. And that seems to be a little bit strange. Why would the palace not have needed to be defended? There are a number of different suggestions that have been made over the years. The first is following Thucydides, the later Greek historian, who wrote that Minos was actually the first man to have a sea empire. He calls it a thalassocracy. And that, therefore, the Minoans were not afraid of being invaded from across the sea. That is, they're on an island. And that does seem to make sense. However, the thalassocracy that Thucydides is talking about is probably not a sea empire, but more rather groups that go abroad to trade, like with Egypt or the Near East, that is, bringing the products of Crete. Still, Crete seems to have had a navy, so it's possible they were not afraid of being attacked from overseas. However, remember, there are six or seven other palaces on Crete, and none of these are fortified. Why weren't the Minoans afraid of each of the palaces being attacked by each other? That is, a civil war. One of the suggestions is that the Minoans were peaceful people, and they didn't fight. This was a theory that was particularly prevalent in the 60s when they called them peaceful, hippie-loving peoples, and that one didn't fly very much at all either. More recently, people have suggested that it's because one single family was ruling all over Crete, and you had, for example, granddad at Knossos, son at Phaistos, another son at Malia, a grandson at Katozakro, a nephew at Hanya, and so on. And so the family is going to be ruling peacefully together, and that's why they're not afraid of internal attack. That seems to me to be a pretty good suggestion. It's also been suggested in books like The Chalice and the Blade that Crete was not ruled by men, but was ruled by women. That is, we have a matriarchy, and that women don't fight, hence you don't need any walls and you're not afraid of attack. I have no problem with the matriarchy. I have a problem with the fact that women don't fight. So I think even if you've got a matriarchy there, that doesn't explain the lack of walls. So whoever's ruling, and indeed we don't know who's ruling, Minos is a figure from Greek mythology, and it was Evans that said he was here. So we don't actually know if it's a king or a queen or a priest or a priestess, but whoever is ruling does not seem to have been afraid of attack for whatever reason. And probably it's because Crete is on an island that really leads to this situation. Now, if we wander around the palace and we come off of the main courtyard in the middle, we wander into what is called the king's throne room. And here again, we don't exactly know who or what was in here. Evans saw that it was the largest such room, and a throne was found in it, so he called it the king's throne room. There are paintings on the wall behind the throne. Evans found a griffin. He thought that there had to be two griffins, so he put another one up on the wall. And this is an example of some of the reconstructions that Evans did. If there was originally one griffin on the wall, there was probably only one griffin there originally. And yet Evans thought that the throne had to be flanked, so he put two griffins there. So what we see today is not necessarily the way that it was in the past. If we wander around a bit more, one notices something that seems a bit unusual, but actually was quite at home there, and that is an entire drainage system. Yes, the Minoans knew plumbing. They had indoor toilets and a very elaborate drainage system for the entire palace. They may have been one of the first peoples in the world to actually do this. They also had windows and seemed to possibly have had some sort of glazed window pane in their windows, which puts them far earlier than people like the Romans, who later had glass as well. So very advanced society we find here on the island of Crete. If we go on the other side of the courtyard, we wander into what Evans called the Queen's Megaron, or the Queen's Throne Room. And here again, he's only calling it that because it is a smaller throne room, and so he thought it should be for the queen. And in this area, we find something interesting. Here's another example of where Evans messed up, shall we say. One of the most famous paintings, at the entire site of Knossos is the so-called dolphin fresco or dolphin mosaic. And here we've got up on a wall some five dolphins that are painted, surrounding by flying fish and other fish as well. The problem with this is that if you read Evans's notebooks, you will note that he found only two such dolphins, and he found them lying on the floor. That is, they had fallen from wherever they had been originally. So Evans looked around the room and tried to figure out where they could have gone originally, saw a big open space on the top of one of the walls, and put them back up there. The only problem is the space was so much bigger than the two dolphins that he added in three more to fill up the rest of the space. And this is now one of the most famous paintings in the entire site of Knossos. The problem here is that Occam's razor should come into play. That is, the simplest answer is the most correct. If Evans found fragments of two dolphins, then there were probably originally only two dolphins. Had there been more, he probably would have found more. So if one looks around this room and tries to figure out where the two dolphins could go, they do not fit on the wall, just as Evans had thought. There's too much space up there. Indeed, they fit perfectly into the floor. And the Minoans, and the Mycenaeans for that matter, were actually well known for their floor paintings. So one has to put this panel with only two dolphins in the middle of the floor, rather than five dolphins up on the wall. Unfortunately, if you mention this fact to your tour guide, he or she will get rather annoyed with you. Still, it might be worth pointing this out if you aren't told that story. If we then go back, retrace our steps to the central courtyard, it's high time I told you what seems to have taken place there. In addition to the probably usual military marches and all of that, if the Minoans had an army or even a standing force of some kind, they also seem to have used the central courtyard as a place for entertainment. And one type of entertainment that they had is something that we call bull leaping. This is kind of like a bullfight, except that the bull is not hurt or killed. It may be more like the Olympics. Let's say it's as if you're doing gymnastics on a pommel horse, except that the pommel horse has horns, weighs about 800 pounds, and is trying to kill you. And what you do is wait till it runs to you, and then grab the horns and flip over it. You do a somersault over the back of this live, breathing bull, and you are caught by your friend and compatriot on the far side. Now, it isn't everyone that can do this. In fact, I rather doubt that I could do it. I'd probably be gored the first time I tried to do it. It takes lithe, flexible gymnasts, probably fairly young, and indeed probably much like we have today. Our gymnasts are usually very young boys and girls, and that's what it takes not to get hurt doing this. Now, this is probably the other part of the myth of Theseus and the Minotaur, because we have bulls here, we have young boys and girls, and the myth of Theseus is stating that seven boys and seven girls are sent from Athens each year over to Crete to King Minos and his half-man, half-bull. And it probably is this whole idea of bull leaping then linked with the later ruins of Knossos that gave rise, or at least was the kernel of truth at the basis of this myth. Now, we have paintings of these bull leapers. That's how we know what happened. We have a wall painting, for example, showing a woman grasping the horns, a man in the middle of flipping over the back, and another woman getting ready to catch him. Now, how can we tell that they are men and women, especially in this case, since they're pretty much prepubescent? Well, the Minoans have a color scheme. The men are always painted red or brown, and women are always painted yellow or white. For that matter, the ancient Egyptians did this as well, and it may be that one got it from the other, because we know the Minoans are in contact with Egypt. So here we've got a woman painted white grasping the horns at the front, a man painted brown flipping over the back, and another woman painted white waiting to grab him. We've also got figurines in ivory depicting this. In particular, there's one which shows somebody flying through the middle of the air. We can tell that this statue would never have stood upright because the feet are pointed at an impossible angle, one which you can reach while flying through midair, but not one which you can do standing. And so, again, we've got these bull leapers coming through the middle of the air. We also have bull's heads made out of stone, steatite, basalt, and other hard stones, with wooden horns covered with gold leaf. And these heads would be hollow, with holes through the nostril, so that if you carried it by the horns, it looked like you were carrying the severed head of a bull, that you hadn't actually severed it. It was a cheap way to do a sacrifice. And we've also got some interesting things. I mentioned that the Minoans are in contact with Egypt and the Near East. And in the early 1990s, 1991, 1992, there was a wall painting found which depicted a man jumping over a bull, and in the background is a maze or a labyrinth. This looks like a wall painting that should be found at Knossos, and it looks like it could be something that gave rise to the myth of Theseus and the Minotaur. But this wall painting is found in Egypt. In fact, it's found in the Nile Delta at a site called Avaris, A-V-A-R-I-S, which was the capital city of the Hyksos, an invading group that took over Egypt for 200 years. Why is such a wall painting found all the way over in Egypt? Well, we don't really know. The only thing that it shows us is that the two groups, the Minoans and the Hyksos, are in contact with each other and that they knew of what each other does. This, though, leads us naturally back to the whole question of storage. You remember I mentioned that the palace at Knossos is a redistribution center, and we have hundreds of storage jars, some of them 6 feet or more in height, that would have held wine and grain, barley, wheat, grapes, olives, all the usual accoutrements of a Greek meal. And in this area, then, we have food from all of the towns and villages that has been brought in to be stored against the winter or other hard times. We also have the famous painting called The Priest King, which Evans said was a portrait of the ruler of the of Knossos. And here we have perhaps one of his most famous mistakes, because The Priest King, which shows a young man walking off to his right and holding a rope that is presumably attached to a bull, is actually made up of three individual figures, not just one, which Evans had thought. And indeed, again, if you read Evans's notebooks, you will notice there is a bit of a problem, because the fragments from this painting were found broken up and scattered in three different rooms. Usually that should mean there are three different paintings. Evans, though, said that this painting had been up on the second floor, and that when the palace collapsed, it had fallen from the second floor to the first floor, had hit the ground so hard that it had bounced into three different rooms, which, at least to my mind, doesn't make an awful lot of sense. In fact, these are the remains of three different figures. There is a woman walking to the right, a man also walking to the right, and a young boy, probably boxing, going off to the left. So we've got here the famous priest king disappears and leaves us with the problem again of exactly who is ruling at Knossos. For us, that doesn't really matter, though, because what we've got in sum is that Minoan Crete was a thriving maritime power that had contacts as far away as Egypt, Cyprus, and even ancient Mesopotamia, modern-day Iraq today, and that it reached its height pretty much between the years 1700 and 1400 BC. Round about the year 1450, or perhaps as late as 1400, some sort of disaster overtook the entire island. We believe that it is an invasion of the Mycenaeans from the Greek mainland, in part because the material culture completely changes on the island after that date. We get new types of pottery. We get new types of burial graves. We get new things in the graves, new types of weapons, and even a new writing system. That is the writing system that we call Linear B, which has been deciphered. We know what it is. It is an early form of Greek, and it is used for the accounting system at the palaces now, not only on Crete, but also back on the Greek mainland. And so in our next lecture, we will turn to the Greek mainland and to the Mycenaeans and take a look at them.
This ends Lecture 1. A History of Ancient Greece, Lecture 2. The Mycenaeans and the Greek mainland.
In this lecture, we will turn to the Greek mainland and to the Mycenaeans, who are present on the mainland from about 1700 down to 1200 BC, a good 500 years during which time they flourished. Let me backtrack for just a second, however, and say again that the Bronze Age in Greece really begins at about the year 3000 BC, which is the time when bronze is invented. That is the amalgamation of copper and tin. 90% copper, 10% tin forms bronze. This becomes the metal of choice for a good 2,000 years. You can also make bronze using arsenic, but that's a little more deadly, and tin is probably a better way to do it. Now, in the early Bronze Age, that is from 3000 down to about 2000 BC, life is flourishing on the Greek mainland, but it's not at a real high level of civilization. Around about the year 2300 BC, there is an invasion of Greece, and a new people comes on in. We're not exactly sure who these people are. They do destroy what's in Greece at that time, about 2300, and then rebuild their own civilization and go on. That period then lasts down to about 1700 BC, which would be the Middle Bronze Age. And then in 1700, we get the coming of the Mycenaeans, which begins the Late Bronze Age. Now, one of the questions we've got in terms of the history of ancient Greece is, when do the Greeks get to Greece? When do the Greeks come to Greece? And these are the two choices either the invaders at about the year 2300 BC, or when the Greeks come to Greece, or when the Mycenaeans get there at about 1700 BC. It is possible that the Mycenaeans are already indigenous, but they do seem to come on in and take over. So our two choices are 2300 or 1700 BC. At the very least, let us say by 1700 BC, the people that we know of as the Greeks are there, or at least in their ancestral forms. This is one of the reasons why I would insist that a history of ancient Greece must start back in the Bronze Age rather than simply at 776 BC, and that one must be familiar with the Mycenaeans in order to understand later Greek culture, history, religion, and everything else. Because as we now know, since we can read the writing of the Mycenaeans, that is, this linear B that was interpreted and translated and deciphered by Michael Ventris in 1952, we now know that linear B is, in fact, an early form of Greek. Now, it's used not to write history or poems or epics or anything else like that. It's used primarily for accounting. It's an economic system. It's recording how many chariots come in and how many pieces of copper go out. But along the way, it mentions some of the gods and goddesses. And we are astonished, perhaps, to learn that Zeus and Hera and Aphrodite and some of the other Greek gods and goddesses are already worshipped in Greece back in this early part of the second millennium BC. So as I say, in order to understand later Greece, you really should go back to the Bronze Age. If we turn specifically to the type site of Mycenae, a type site is something that gives its name to the entire culture, very much like Evans called the Minoans after King Minos and Knossos. Here we've got another modern explorer and another name for everybody using a type site. Mycenae gives its name to the civilization. Again, we don't really know what they called themselves. It may be that they're already calling Greece Hellas, which is what it will be called later, and themselves Hellenes, but we don't really know this for sure. The Egyptians don't help out much. They have a name, Tanaya, which may be the name for the Greeks. And even Homer doesn't help out all that much. He calls them the Danaans, and this may be related to Tanaya. But throughout it all, again, we're looking at what other people called this group, and we don't actually have their name for them themselves. But again, that may not matter. In any event, when they do come on in and start living at Mycenae, they give their name to this culture because of one modern explorer, namely Heinrich Schliemann, the man that archaeologists and ancient historians love to hate. This is the man who discovered the site of Troy and proved, at least to his satisfaction, that the Trojan War had taken place, as we will look at briefly in our next lecture. But not content with finding the Trojans, he wanted, according to the Iliad and the Odyssey, to find the people who fought against them, namely the Mycenaeans. So Schliemann came to the Greek mainland in the 1800s, found himself a wife, married a woman named Sophia, in part because she could read the Iliad in the original Greek, and set out to find Mycenae. It wasn't hard to find Mycenae at all. In fact, all he had to do was to ask the local villagers of the village called Mycenae where ancient Mycenae was, and they pointed. And indeed, the famous Lion Gate that one walks through today to get into the city was still standing so that the lions were still visible. We're not actually sure these are lions. In fact, they're probably lionesses, if they're anything. But their heads are missing, and they are standing on top of the entry, the gateway into Mycenae, probably forming a heraldic crest of the royal family, is our best guess. So this gate, the Lion Gate, was still standing when Schliemann came in the late 1800s and began excavating. In fact, it was around the year 1876 or thereabouts that Schliemann went through the Lion Gate and decided to try to find the graves of Agamemnon and his followers. Now, those of you that are still familiar with Greek mythology and Greek legend, we will go into the story of the Trojan War, as I mentioned, in the next lecture. Suffice it to say here that when Agamemnon came home successfully from the Trojan War, he was met by his wife Clytemnestra and her lover, because she had been unfaithful, and Agamemnon was murdered in the bathtub, along with five or six of his followers, who were also killed. And later Greeks, including one traveler writing much later, Pausanias, tells the story that Agamemnon and his men were buried just inside the city walls. And so Schliemann decided to try to find them. Now, he didn't actually have a permit to excavate. That didn't stop him. But he went inside the Lion Gate, and within a matter of days, because this man was extremely lucky, he found what has since been called the shaft graves. This is a grave circle. In fact, this is a grave circle A, as we now call it, immediately inside the Lion Gate, just off to the right. And within this grave circle can be seen five or six very deep graves dug in the manner of a shaft going down, with the tomb then at the bottom, hence the name Shaft Grave Tomb. And in these graves, Schliemann found men. He found bodies, and he found grave goods, swords, dozens of swords, gold, something like 480 kilograms worth of gold objects, all kinds of things. It's the richest set of graves that had ever been found in Greece up until that time. And Schliemann naturally assumed that he had found the graves of Agamemnon and his men. And indeed, it wasn't an unwarranted assumption, because that is what the ancient authors had said. The only problem was, when they started studying the pottery, it quickly became pretty clear to everybody, including Schliemann, that these could not be the graves of Agamemnon and his men, because they dated from a period 400 years before the Trojan War. That is, they date back to about 1650 BC, and we think the Trojan War took place about 1250 BC. So if these aren't Agamemnon and his men, then who are they? Well, they're probably the graves of the first kings of Mycenae, these people that came in at about 1700 BC and founded the entire city and indeed the entire dynasty. So that's probably who we are looking at. But Schliemann didn't realize that at first, and he announced to the world that he had found Agamemnon. In fact, he invited the king of Greece to come visit and to see the mask that he had found. Indeed, Schliemann sent a telegram to the king of Greece saying, "I have gazed upon the face of Agamemnon." Well, it wasn't Agamemnon, but yeah, it still worked. The king came up to Mycenae, and Schliemann showed him a wonderful mask of a very regal-looking man. It's a gold death mask is what he showed him. It was placed over the face of one of the bodies. In fact, a number of the bodies had these masks on them. And this particular one, which you can now see in the National Museum in Athens, is very regal-looking, with a mustache and a beard. And this, the tour guide will tell you, is the one that Schliemann showed to the king and that had prompted him to send the telegram in the first place. Actually, that story is not quite true. Schliemann had found one of the other masks. It's a nice, round, jovial, friendly-looking man. He looks kind of like your next-door neighbor. But in between the time that he found that and had sent the telegram, Schliemann found the other one, much more regal-looking, and so it was that second mask that Schliemann showed the king when he showed up. Indeed, there are even some people now who suspect that Schliemann had that regal-looking mask forged, or at least touched up, because the mustache and the beard looked Victorian and not at all like the Mycenaeans look like. So they're thinking that maybe he had it touched up at some point. Nevertheless, these were spectacular finds. Indeed, some of the bodies, Schliemann said when he lifted off the gold mask, the face was still there, including the skin, but that it crumbled to dust even as he watched. I think that's probably a bit of Schliemann's imagination at play. He did tend to make things up, as we know from other scenarios. And yet it is still kind of interesting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.